Yes, start, yeah, please.
Yeah, Anish, we can start. Sunil bhai, you can start now. Sunil bhai. Yeah, Sunil bhai, you can start.
Yeah. So, Rajesh, would you want to start first?
Yeah, yeah. Oh. Yeah, one. Yeah, okay. Welcome, friends, to this meeting on recent international tax jurisdictional decisions by Mr. Sunil Lala. He will be dealing with the subject from January 2019 onwards. Whatever decisions, important decisions are there, he will be taking it up. And we are thankful to him for accepting our invitation for dealing in the subject. It will be in two parts. He will be dealing around 40 decisions and he will divide it into two parts as his own list, taking on the importance of it. And we thank Tarun Singhal also to get connected with Sunil bhai and persuade him to give this lectures. And with this brief, I will hand over to Anish to have a brief word. He is the Vice President of the Chamber. Yeah, Anish. Anish, you are muted.
Yeah, thank you, Rajesh. Good evening, everybody. Gives us great pleasure to welcome you again to this two-part series on international tax decisions. You know, in the past year or so, there have been several decisions which are noteworthy. Several decisions which we need to discuss. And Sunil has been kind enough and gracious enough to analyze those decisions for us. And I'm sure we're going to have a fantastic 2 days. Without too much ado, let me not stand before you and Sunil, since we are already delayed because of the Learned FM's announcement. So may I request Harshal to introduce Sunil briefly, and then Sunil can take over. Thank you very much.
Yeah, sure, Anish. So it is my privilege to introduce the speaker. In fact, Sunil bhai doesn't need any introduction. Everyone is aware that we have been the beneficiaries, you know, of his constant contribution to the field of international tax decisions, both before the courts and off the courts. Everyone knows that ITAT Online publishes his digest of international tax decisions, transfer pricing decisions, domestic tax decisions from time to time. So it was probably, you know, natural choice that we would invite Dr. Sunil Lala for this wonderful session. It would be unfair not to give a formal introduction to him, for him. So I would like to introduce him formally. So Dr. Sunil Moti Lala has done his PhD from Mumbai University in International Tax and Transfer Pricing with respect to BEPS, GAR and other critical issues in the global arena. So in fact, he has also given, you know, around 106 suggestions to the OECD and the Indian government on various international tax topics such as BEPS, GAR, POEM and other topics. He's an advocate and a qualified chartered accountant practicing at SML Tax Chamber as a tax counsel, having over 25 years of experience in the field of direct taxes. He has acquired training in the chambers of senior advocates of Supreme Court, Mr. Dinesh Vyas and Mr. V.H. Patil. And also under Mr. Nihal Dalvi. He was previously a partner and head of direct tax litigation practice in PwC Western Region, KPMG and Advaita Legal as a co-founder. He has been regularly recognized as one of the tax controversy leaders in India by International Tax Review for the past 6 consecutive years. He has advised and regularly advises and represents several MNCs in challenging cases before courts, tribunal, AR, etc. And he has been, you know, involved in various organizations such as ITAT Bar Organization, Association, Foundation for International Taxation, International Fiscal Association, AIFTP, and the Chamber in the capacity of a trustee, office bearer, and a member of managing committee. And as we all know, Sunil bhai also contributes regularly in various professional journals and also in the financial newspapers. I think with a short introduction, let me not hold him. Sir, all over to you now.
Yeah, before Sunil starts, just my apologies because we had to shift this from 4 p.m. to 5:30 p.m. because of the FM press conference. And then also, just now also, we are slightly delayed because the press conference went up to 5:30. So I think Sunil bhai, just can you take over now? Sunil bhai?
Sir, you are muted right now. I think there seems to be some connectivity issue.
Yeah, I'm calling him out. Hello, Sunil. Yeah, okay. Before Sunil bhai speaks or joins it, he will be dealing with 40 decisions in two sessions. So there may not be time for question answers, Q&A, because this only will take time, because what I understand from is there are more than 180 slides which he and his team has prepared. So it might not be possible to take question. If it is there, then we will surely take it if the time is available.
You'll have to unmute yourself.
Sunil bhai, you will have to unmute yourself.
Hello.
Yeah.
Am I audible?
Yeah, you are audible.
Yeah.
So you can continue. Sunil bhai, what we'll do is we'll put all ourselves on unmute ourselves, and we'll just stop our video also, so that the connectivity is not a problem.
Okay. Yeah. Am I visible? Am I visible and the presentation both are visible?
Yes, Sunil, both are.
Okay.
If there is anything you can just tell us from here only.
So. Okay, sure. Thank you. Yeah.
Request all of you to just mute yourself and off your video. Yes, Sunil bhai, go ahead.
Yeah. So, good evening, friends. At the outset, thank you for this overwhelming response. I was informed by the chamber that there were some 700-800 registrations and quite a mind-boggling figure. This shows everybody's love for the subject. So, a very good evening and thank you all. And since there may be so many people on the call, Jai Shri Krishna, Jai Janindra, Salam Walikum and Sat Sri Akal to all. At the outset, my thanks to Rajesh for giving me this opportunity in this lockdown to do some studies. To be honest, many of his summaries in this Chambers Journal I have used and incorporated in this presentation. I'd also like to thank my colleague, my junior Harsh Bafna, chartered accountant, who has taken painstaking efforts to make this 185 slides. And last but not the least, a friend of mine, Rajiv Bedekar, who is a chartered accountant now based in Singapore, with whom I have brainstormed a lot, and he's a very learned person, and my thanks to him as well. So friends, I hope most of you have been making most of this lockdown period. And really, there are two ways to look at it. Some people say what cannot be cured must be endured. And that's really a pessimistic way to look at it. The other way really is, if nothing can be done, then you must at least have fun. And I hope most of us are at least coming in the second category and enjoying this lockdown the way I have been doing. And as I said, since there are two opinions to everything, international tax, there can be two and more opinions on that. And the object of this webinar is not really just to discuss the case laws in the last 15 months or so, that these are the facts and these are the rulings. I thought the object of this webinar is if we could enhance our knowledge of international tax by studying the case laws which are connected together. So by taking connected case laws together, if we could enhance our knowledge, clarify certain concepts, maybe add some confusion to those concepts, and maybe reflect later on. So I think that is the object what I have kept in mind, enhancing our knowledge through case laws, recent case laws in the last 15 months. Also, as regards the approach of the webinar, friends, it's my firm belief, if you want to solve or answer any problem, then you must, the answer of the problem lies very often in the problem itself. If one can get to the crux of the problem or the root of the problem, then really more than half the battle is won if you can identify the root problem or the crux of the problem. So if I just give an analogy in a lighter way, on a spiritual plane, if one goes to Guru and says, look, I have this anger problem. After a lot of analysis, the person may realize that, no, really the problem is of the ego. So the apparent problem may be anger, but actually it's the ego. Or if one looks at a physical health, somebody may complain that the knees are paining. And the problem may not be in the knees, the problem may be in the weight. Similarly, if we have to solve a problem in income tax, to my mind, if we could spend some time on, when there are complicated facts given, if we can pick up those two, three most critical facts, and in the ocean of the income tax law, if we can pick up the two or three words in the act, connect those two, three critical facts with those two, three words or phrases, phrases in the act with the actual facts, really we get the answer to the problem. But many of us miss that point out, we may not identify the right words or the critical facts. So in this webinar, my approach is going to be, even while discussing case laws, I would like to spend some time on the issue and the actual provision of the law. So that is the approach.
Can you be slightly louder, or you can take your mic to near your...
Okay. So that's going to be the approach, really. Also, as we go in the 185 slides, some of y'all may feel a little cheated that, I didn't read all the slides. So don't feel cheated. I think the chamber will be also circulating this presentation of 185 slides. And if you don't read all of it, it's all right. But just for the benefit of all, if you can read the bold part, and in the bold part also, there is a particular style we've adhered to. So anything you see marked in red is the revenue's contention, or if it's a finding of the court, then it's a finding in favor of the revenue. If you see anything in blue, then that blue is the assessee's contention or the finding of the court in favor of the assessee. So just by knowing red and blue, you'll know red is against the assessee, blue is in favor of the assessee. And that just might help, because we will be spending some 4 hours together over two sessions. And I thought this tip might just help you to appreciate the slides better. With this, we have taken 40 case laws, over 15 topics. So let's see out of the 40 case laws, and if we can cover even three topics today, which cover about 21 case laws, I think that will be an achievement, but we won't hurry it up. We'll try how much ever of the 21 we can do. So our first category is permanent establishment, where we'll be dealing with three case laws on liaison office, two on DAPE, two on service PE, one on construction PE, one on multiple PE. So 9 issues, if you see the issue column, you'll realize that the 9 issues there are dealing with permanent establishment. Then on royalty, we have again 5 issues on bandwidth charges, TV channel, royalty particular to TV channel, web hosting, training and simulator charges, supply of design, that's as far as royalty. And as far as fees for technical services are concerned, whether training may and sub, most of the case laws are there on make available, but there aren't many case laws on ancillary and subsidiary. We found one last year, and I put that supply of designs, referral fees, secondment of employees, we've taken 3 in that category. So this is something, if we can cover from this today, that would be our target. And of course, on the next occasion, we will try to cover capital gains tax avoidance, independent personal services, interest, other income, shipping company, operation of aircraft, tax, foreign tax credit, non-discrimination, tiebreaker, and relevance of TRC. Of course, this is not for today, but on the next occasion. So if I may start, with the first first category of cases, permanent establishment, there are 9 cases here, 3 dealing with liaison office. Now, as most of you are aware, on liaison office, there are a number of decisions and contrary views, diverse views. And really, one can't lay down a legal principle broadly, okay, this is a covered matter and therefore this will apply. Therefore, it is a liaison office or not a liaison office. And it all boils down to the facts of the case. On this case, the Supreme Court judgment. So if you see, if a decision is marked in blue, the heading is in blue, that means it's in favor of the SSC. So I've taken up this case because I'm seeing some people express reservations on this favorable view, which we'll discuss a little later. So here the issue is, here you have a UAE entity rendering remittance services. So this entity in UAE has its clients. Those clients give this entity some money, and this money has to be transferred to a beneficiary in India. And for rendering this service, this UAE entity charges them 15 dirhams per transactions. This is the fact. Most of the activity is done by the UAE entity, which is everything is done outside of India. Except that when the client in UAE wants a physical check to be delivered to the beneficiary in India, at that point of time, the liaison office of this UAE entity comes in. And the liaison office really makes the check and couriers the check to the beneficiary in India. These are the facts. So if we see the relevant provision, we all know that liaison office is a fixed place. Normally, a fixed place would be a permanent establishment unless, and the relevant article here is 5.3e, which says that a PE shall be deemed not to include the maintenance of a fixed place solely for the activity of a preparatory or auxiliary character. So what is critical here right now is the main business of this UAE entity for which it is earning money in UAE, is they will take money from the client in UAE, let us say, and the money will be transferred to a beneficiary in India. One way to look at it is that really the money this UAE entity is getting is for the transfer of money into India. And if that be the case, then it's a core business activity. And if that be the case, then the liaison office in India is actually carrying out an integral part of the business activity, which cannot be considered as preparatory or auxiliary in character. The other view is, ultimately, let us see. This is the view of the revenue. The other view is that ultimately, what is the liaison office doing in India? They are just merely taking out a check, filling the amount, and couriering it to the beneficiary in India. Which so to say is a very, my office boy do something like that also. Now, can this be a core business activity? This is the issue here. So let us see the facts. I've already mentioned the facts now. See the second and third bullet, please. So the SSC had 4 liaison offices in India, which carried on the activities in accordance with the conditions imposed by the RBI. This is important. The expenses for maintaining the liaison office was received from the head office in UAE. And the LO did not charge any fee or commission for the services rendered in India in compliance with the conditions imposed by RBI. The SSC in UAE entered into contracts outside of India, took the money from them, transferred it to the beneficiaries in India. But there were 2 ways to do it. One was a telegraphic transfer where the liaison office had no role to play. And the second was on the request of the customer, the SSC dispatched the instrument, that is the liaison office, issued the checks or the drafts to the beneficiaries in India. The AR, the matter went to the AR. Before the AR, the SSC's contention was that the activities undertaken by the LO are only supportive and auxiliary in nature, and therefore it would come under the exception, and it would not be a fixed place of a business in India. It would not be a PE in India. The contention of the revenue was that, look, the LOA is connected to the main service, main server, and it is actually carrying on the core business activity, and therefore it's not a supporting activity. The AR did the issue against the SSC, and the LO would cause the presence. The commission which the SSC was actually for remit the amount which covered the activities in UAE, but also the activity undertaken by the liaison office. And therefore, the AR held that this activity could went to the High Court. The High Court relied on the Supreme Court decision, which was really with back office services, and said that the undertaken by this LO was clearly auxiliary in nature. I'm not too sure about the reliance on the Morgan Stanley judgment, but I'm in agreement with the conclusion of the High Court. Against this, the department went to the Supreme Court, and the Supreme Court, this is what they held. They placed a heavy reliance on the approval given by the RBI for establishing the LO in India. And the condition clearly was that the LO was not allowed to enter into any contract with any person in India, nor was the LO allowed to charge any fees or commission. So this was the first critical observation of the Supreme Court. Then the Supreme Court said, now let us get into the definition of the words preparatory and auxiliary. So when they went to preparatory, they found preparatory means materials used in preparing the ultimate form of an agreement or statute. The ultimate form here is you are preparing for the ultimate delivery to the check or to the beneficiary. Or, and the auxiliary definition was aiding or supporting a subsidiary or supplementary. The Supreme Court observed that the LO was conducting a combination of virtual and physical activities, that is downloading the particulars of remittances, though remaining connected to the main server of the SSC in UAE, then printing the checks and drafts, which in turn was couriered or dispatched to the beneficiaries in India as per the instructions of the NRI remitter. Supreme Court further held that RBI had given a permission to the SSC to open a LO for conducting activities such as responding to queries from correspondent banks, reconciliation of bank accounts, act as a communication center, printing the rupee drafts, etc. Supreme Court said that the LO was clearly, the underlined part, was clearly not allowed to take any commercial activities, and hence the activities carried on by the LO were in the nature of preparatory or auxiliary nature. They also noted that the LO was merely downloading information from the main server of the respondent in UAE and printing the checks or drafts. And clearly this was a support service which would not give rise to a fixed place PE in India. So the Supreme Court upheld the order of the High Court. Now, currently, there have been some views on this, and that the Supreme Court has unduly placed reliance on the RBI approval. And is that the correct position? This is part of the core activity of the SSC, because ultimately the SSC in UAE is getting money to get the money delivered into India. And that activity is being done by the Indian liaison office. And really would this not amount to a core business activity and therefore not auxiliary? This is one of the views. So if one goes through the settled case laws, the principles laid down are that if the activity, what we have to consider whether it's a core activity, it is integral to the business activity, is there revenue generation in the activity? What is the quantum of expenditure? And are there technical, is there presence of technical expats? Now, as far as the last three are concerned, there was no revenue, as per the, you know, there was no revenue generation in India, so to say. In fact, the LO could not get into any commercial transactions. The quantum of expenditure was really met by the UAE entity. There were no technical expats. And as regards core or integral is concerned, really the Supreme Court said that, you see, when this activity is being carried out, the Dubai, the UAE entity is dealing with the client, negotiating with the client, ensuring that the client adheres to the KYC norms, taking records, uploading all the information on the server, passing on that details to the Indian entity. And the Indian entity early making a check and couriering it. Therefore, if one sees the main activity, so to say, in terms of the effort is happening in UAE. And a very minuscule effort really is happening in India. And therefore, nevertheless, though it may sound to be like in a core business activity, considering the nature of activity involved, it was really nothing but a auxiliary activity. And I would believe that this is really the right position what the Supreme Court has taken. Now, let's take another situation of another case of liaison office. In the case of Hitachi High Technologies, this is a Delhi tribunal decision. Since it's unread on top, which means this is in against the SSC. So here, there are two things are important. One is what was the activity being done and what is the treaty? What are the words in the treaty? Here, the activity done by the liaison office was that of price negotiation, obtaining orders, following up on delivery, ascertaining customer requirements. This was being done in India. And it was claimed that these were nothing but preparatory auxiliary in nature, and therefore there was no PE. This LO did not constitute a PE. Now, the tribunal went into the treaty and said, you know, this treaty is differently worded from the UAE treaty. So this treaty says, a PE shall deemed not to include the maintenance of a fixed place solely for the purpose of advertising or for the supply of information for scientific research or for similar activities which have a preparatory auxiliary character for the enterprise. What the tribunal held, they were influenced by this latter phrase, which says, or for similar activities which have a preparatory auxiliary character. So now if we see the critical, as I said, the critical fact is the fact of price negotiation, obtaining orders, etc. Does it amount to a similar activity? An activity which is similar to advertising, supply of information or scientific research, which have a preparatory auxiliary character. So there are two things. Apart from being preparatory auxiliary character, that is the second issue. Are the activities similar to these activities? Let's see what the tribunal held. So I've just explained the facts and these contentions. Now here, the contention of the SSC, this is important. Contention of the SSC was that the core business activities are that of trading operations. So the Singapore entity, its core business activity was that of trading operations. And the LO was acting as a communication channel, providing logistic support. The LO, therefore, could not be considered as a fixed place because it was clearly auxiliary in nature. These activities were clearly auxiliary in nature. And further, this is critical, SSC argued that the RBI had not found any violation in the nature of activities carried out by the LO, and it could not be presumed that the LO was engaged in any commercial activities in India. The contention of the revenue was that, look, see the activities. The activities are price negotiation, what I've underlined in purple, what I've boxed in purple, ascertaining customer requirements, obtaining their orders, and these cannot be considered as auxiliary. These are core critical activities, and therefore it's not a preparatory auxiliary activity. The tribunal noted that the LO was undertaking core activities of the SSC in India, and hence the SSC indeed carried on business in India. The activities would not fall within the exclusionary clause. And now this is important. So this reasoning of the tribunal is Article 57E of the India-Singapore DTA says, it says for similar activities, and therefore similar activities means activities like, I'm on the third bullet, advertising, supply of information, or scientific research. And they said this is noticeably different from the activities carried out for the activities mentioned in treaties like Canada or USA, trying to suggest that if the entity was a Canadian or a US entity, things would have been different. But in Singapore, the language is similar activities to advertising, etc., and anything beyond that will not get the exclusion. This was a important finding of the important reasoning of the tribunal. Now, with respect, I agree with the conclusion of what the tribunal has held, that this seems to be clearly auxiliary or preparatory in nature. But I'm not so convinced about this reasoning, which is, unlike treaties in Canada or USA. So here I've noted a case which I've written in hand in purple below, a case of Brown and Sharp, which is reported in 51 Taxman 327 Allahabad, which was dealing with the US treaty. And again, the activity of the LO was negotiation. And they said, no, it's a core business activity. And therefore, there would be a PE, though it was a US treaty. So what really comes out from both these judgments? So in the first case, the Supreme Court went by the RBI approval, took note of the RBI approval. And in the second case, despite the RBI approval and the RBI not finding any flaw, the tribunal took a decision against the SSC. So how does one, are the two really contrary decisions? Though they may seem so, in my view, they are not contrary to each other. What merely comes out from both these decisions is that the RBI approval or the conditions of the RBI definitely have persuasive value. So an SSC can say, look, as per the RBI, I cannot do these activities and I can do only these. And therefore, he can rely on that and say prima facie, therefore, obviously, that I'm not carrying out a core business activity. But this presumption is certainly rebuttable, because if one finds that actually you're carrying out an activity which is different. Now, I'm on slide number 16. Now, in this particular case, there was a survey operation. And in the survey operation, the statement employer supported by emails was found. And it was found that the LOs were engaged in advertisement, marketing. Though the SSC was saying it's just a liaison office communication channel, but what was actually found was that they are doing advertisement, marketing, conducting market survey, market research, sales promotion, admin and activities such as price negotiation, ascertaining customer, So they said, though your RBI approval, whatever, but in the survey, what has come out is something different. And therefore, they were not influenced by the RBI. Whereas, in the first case of UAE, it was not a question of a finding. It was an inference drawn on an undisputed fact. And the undisputed fact in the first case UAE was that the liaison office was merely making a check and couriering it. It was the legal inference in the case drawn, whether this amounts to auxiliary or not. Whereas in the second case, there was a factual finding given that the activities were not auxiliary in nature. So there's a difference between the two. And though they may seem apparently contrary, because one has gone by the RBI, one has not gone by the RBI. But the fact of the matter is, RBI is only persuasive. It can raise a presumption which is rebuttable. And Supreme Court, there was no adverse finding against the SSC by the AAR in terms of a finding of fact. It was just an inference drawn that the activity was a core business activity. There was no dispute in the first case that it was just issuing checks. So these are the two views, one in favor and one against the SSC. And what really comes out, I will not take much time on this. So ultimately, whether the liaison office is carrying out a supporting activity, is it auxiliary or is it a main activity, would depend on the facts of the case. You're the Japan company in Japan had an LO in India. RBI permission was there not to carry on any business activities in India. However, there was a survey and certain files were impounded. And so on the basis of the documents, the AO inferred, he rebutted the presumption of the RBI and said no core business activities were being carried out. Now, the tribunal, what they held, they said that first of all, whatever document was found which spoke of the business activity did not pertain to the relevant year. And the other documents which pertain to the relevant year really pertain to the an invoice raised by an independent agent of the head office in India. And those bills were found in the liaison office, because a meeting was to be held between the head office and the independent agent. And since those Japanese people would not be able to understand the independent agent in India because of the language issue, the liaison office would merely come from a language perspective and act as a translator. And these documents only proved that. And if this was the function, then notwithstanding what the AO was said, they held that this could not be a liaison of, it could not be held to be a PE, and this was clearly an auxiliary or support or preparatory nature. So these are the three cases what we dealt with, and I've just discussed the conclusion of all this, and that is that the RBI presumption, RBI is persuasive, but raises a presumption which is rebuttable, and ultimately it will depend on the facts of the case, which the AO can strengthen it, which the tribunal can reject or may accept. So this was on liaison office. Now we come next to the issue of DAPE. We'll take two cases on this. So here the provisions are known, so I won't... The issue here is, this is a case of Taj Mauritius, which is running a TV channel, which has an exclusive distributor in India, let's say that is Taj India. Taj India is carrying on two activities. One is that of an advertising agent. So when you see these ads coming on your TV, they are the advertising agent, and they operate with Taj Mauritius. The other activity which Taj India does is the distribution of the channel in India. So Taj India deals with the cable operators in India, and whatever revenue they get, that is shared between Taj India and Mauritius in the ratio of 60-40. Now here the issue arises, as far as advertisement agreement is concerned, the AO said that clearly Taj India had an authority to conclude contracts, which, you know, prior to the MLI, this was a prerequisite condition. Right now it is if you're playing a principal role in the conclusion of contracts, but before, if you had an authority to conclude contracts, then it would clearly be a dependent agent PE. That was for the finding given by the AO. And they said clearly Taj India is a DAPE. Second, as far as the distribution agreement is concerned, they said that only Taj India has the exclusive right to represent the cable operators on behalf of the SSC. And therefore, both the incomes earned by Taj Mauritius, which is from distribution, where they were getting 40%, where they were getting 60% of the revenue, as well as the entire 90% of the revenue, would be taxable in India to the extent attributable to this Taj, to the DAPE in the form of Taj India. Now, this is an interesting issue. So, CIT appeal observed with respect to advertisement agreement the Taj India was fully dependent on the SSC for its activities, and Taj India constituted a PE. As regards distribution agreement, the CIT appeal said no. Taj India, the second bullet, the Taj India had acquired rights of distribution of channel from the SSC on its own behalf. And hence it was held that Taj India did not constitute a PE of the SSC as per Article 5.4 of the India-Mauritius Treaty. Now, this is important. Is the SSC's appeal with respect to advertisement agreement was dismissed as being time-barred. So it seems maybe the SSC would have thought not to go and appeal on this aspect because clearly an authority was there to conclude contracts. Maybe strategically they just filed an appeal, and it's good if a member can, you know, say both appeals dismissed. It's maybe that was the strategy. So this appeal was dismissed as being time-barred. As regards the distribution, the tribunal's observation was that Taj India was acting independently for the distribution rights, and the entire agreement was on a principle-to-principle basis, and hence the DAPE was not established. They further held that, okay, the Taj India was dealing with the cable operators, you know, that's fine. But there was no authority to conclude contracts in the name of Mauritius. They were directly dealing with, second bullet, Taj India was not acting as an agent of the SSC, but had entered into contract with the other parties, the sub-distribution agreements, cable operators, etc., in its own name, in which the SSC, which is Mauritius, was not the party. And then they held that this would not amount to a DAPE. Now, friends, what comes out here is normally, if you have a DAPE in India, the tendency of the revenue is that all activities, all revenue generated from the DAPE should be taxable. But I thought this was a very good judgment where they said, no, you can be a DAPE for one business activity and you need not be a DAPE for the other business activity. The income of FCO, foreign company, therefore need not be taxed in India because it cannot be attributed to the DAPE because for the second activity, there is no DAPE. So this was, I thought, an important aspect here. We take a second case of second example of DAPE. Now, we are concerned with the Germany treaty here. Here, I may just read the provisions. It says, a person other than an agent of an independent status shall be deemed to be a PE if this person has an authority to conclude contracts on behalf of the foreign enterprise. Now, the facts here, which comes out in the issue, is whether here Audi India was buying its car. So the SSC is a German entity. So Audi Germany was selling its cars to Audi India or Volkswagen, which is their group concern in India, as a sole distributor in India on a principle to principle basis. Whether this particular transaction where Audi Germany is selling cars to its Indian counterpart or its Indian group company as a sole distributor, whether this would constitute a business connection or a PE in India as per the treaty. And the really one has to focus on this DAPE provision. So the Indian entity is called Volkswagen. The AOS case was that the SSC had a business connection in India and a PE as well under the India-Germany treaty in the form of Volkswagen, because Volkswagen was the exclusive distributor of the SSC and the activities of Volkswagen were devoted wholly for the SSC. That was the allegation of the AO. The SSC's contention was that the delivery and the title of cars was transferred outside India and no income could be attributed in India as income had accrued outside India. So Audi Germany would sell the cars to Volkswagen in India, so to say, outside of India. And this was the contention of the SSC. And second was that the SSC in any case was not selling the cars on behalf of the SSC. The revenue's contention was, now this is, the revenue contended that most of the senior officials of Volkswagen, which is the IQ, had come from Audi Group abroad, and activities such as storage, marketing, advertisement, after-sales service and support, supply of spare parts, accessories, were done by Volkswagen on behalf of the SSC and were carried out from its fixed place of business in India. Second, they said Volkswagen is nothing but an extended arm of the SSC. And therefore, the revenue contended that by relying on the AR ruling in Aramics, clearly this was a DAPE, the Indian entity was a DAPE. And the sale made by Audi Germany to India was taxable in India. The tribunal held that the cars were manufactured outside India and sold outside India. Accordingly, the same constituted a separate and different activity. The revenue had not provided any evidence to rebut the claim of the SSC that the cars were not sold to Volkswagen on a principle-to-principle basis. So there was nothing, there was just an allegation, but there was nothing to prove so. They relied on Daimler's case and distinguished Aramics by saying that in Aramics was a case of a courier where there was where the client would deal with the EFCO Aramics outside of India, and that parcel had to be delivered into India, and Aramics India, so to say, was completing the transaction. And they said, ki, look, there it was really one transaction which was happening for the particular client outside of India. Here, there are two limbs to the transaction. So the sale has already happened outside of India between Audi Germany and Volkswagen India. And Volkswagen India is selling cars to its customers in India on a principle-to-principle basis. So two transactions are separate, unlike in Aramics. Now, the question here arises, so there are two reasons given by the tribunal, so to say. One is that the cars are sold outside India. And second is that Volkswagen, the Indian company, is dealing with its customers in India on a principle-to-principle basis. Let's take in this very fact, what if the cars were delivered in India? What if Audi, Germany, sold the cars to Volkswagen India and the delivery really happened in India? And assuming the first bullet, therefore, would not apply, would the tribunal still decide in favor of the SSC if the sale had not happened outside of India? To my mind, the answer would be, even if the sale had happened, so to say, in India, so long as the second condition is fulfilled, that is, the Volkswagen dealing on a principle-to-principle basis, so it purchases from Audi. After that, whether it sells the cars, at what rate it sells it, whether it gives a discount, whether it has bad debts, whatever else, all the risk is that principle basis, the question of DAPE does not arise, and whether the cars are sold in India or outside India would not really be critical. So here I just want to point out that many times, you know, this is an additional plus point in the case right now, that the cars are sold outside of India. But the absence of an additional plus point does not become a minus point. Fair enough, this case may be better than that other case where cars are sold into India. But here it's an additional plus. If that additional plus is not there, it's not becoming a minus point. To my mind, it would still not be a DAPE. To highlight this, let's take an example. Let's say that Volkswagen India had a branch in Germany. And these cars, so to say, the delivery was taking in Germany, and Volkswagen India, so the transaction is happening there, and Volkswagen India, or delivery is happening there, Volkswagen India is entering into a contract with an Indian customer and saying, they're concluding the contract with the Indian customer saying, now the goods will come from Germany. So what is important here is, in the second case, once they're concluding contracts in India, then irrespective of where the delivery is taken, clearly there would be a DAPE. Because then you're clearly acting on behalf of Audi India. Whereas in this case, though the transaction between Volkswagen India and the customers is on a principle-to-principle basis, and therefore there should not be a DAPE. So these were two issues on a DAPE. Now we come to service PE. Service PE here, this will be important to read the provision first. And before that, So a permanent establishment shall include the furnishing of services within a contracting state by an enterprise through employees if the activities of that nature continue within that state for a period or periods aggregating to more than 90 days within any 12-month period. So here, let's take a situation where now the issue here is to determine the threshold of a service PE, which is 90 days in a 12-month period under the India-UK DTA, whether any 12-month period appearing in Article 5.2K needs to be construed as a previous financial year, or can it mean any 12 months? So let us take a situation where the foreign entity has rendered service in India in the month of March for 50 days and in the following April for 40 days. So if we say any 12-month period literally, then both March and April put together would be 50 and 40, 90 days, and there would be a service PE, and any income arising from this service would be attributable to this service PE, and it would be taxable in India. Now, so this is the issue. Now let's take another situation. Is, as I said, in this March, we are taking off, let's say March 20 and April 20 was the first example. Let's take another case where it is April 19 and March 20. Same thing. So those the 40 days of April of 2020 have gone into 40 days of April 2019. Would it really make a difference? Because from a revenues perspective, they will say that no, there is a PE in both situations. Because if you talk from April 19 to March 20, 90 days are up. If you talk from March 20 to April 20, also 90 days are up. And in both the scenarios, there will be a PE. What the tribunal has held, I'm on slide 33, is that when you talk of any 12-month period as used in Article 5.2K1, they are saying that this any 12-month period has not been defined anywhere in the tax treaty. Therefore, the meaning of the said expression could be taken with the aid of provisions of the Act, since the income is sought to be taxed in India. And if one goes to section 4, which is the charging section, then income tax is always in respect of a total in previous year. And the previous year is defined to be a financial year. So if you extend the logic that income, which is taxed, is of a previous year means financial year. And therefore, when you're talking of taxability, that any 12-month period must mean that any 12-month period must refer to the financial year itself, and it cannot mean literally any 12-month period. This is what they held. Therefore, by virtue of this decision, if 90 days are in India, 50 days in April 19, 40 days in April 19 and 50 days in April 20, there will be a service PE. But if it is 50 days in March 20, and 40 days in April 20, which the financial year changes, there will not be a service PE. So this was an interpretation where they went beyond the literal meaning of any 12-month period. Because if you go by the literal meaning of any 12-month period, In both the scenarios I mentioned, there would be a service PE. But they went into the object that why are we doing this? We are doing it to tax the SSE. SSE is taxed on his income. Income is total income for the previous year, and previous year means financial year, and therefore 12-month period must essentially mean the financial year or the previous year. The next issue which arises again on service PE is, let's see, while determining the threshold of 90 days under the India-UK DTA, whether multiple counting of employees present on the same day is permissible and whether leaves taken by the employee is to be excluded. So let's take a situation that this UK entity has sent its employees into India. Let's take three employees, A, B, C. Has been in India from month of January. B has been in India for February, and C was in March. 90 days are up, and therefore clearly there would be a service PE. So you would, because it says activities, if you see, I'm referring to 5K below that activities of by an enterprise through its employees, if activities of that nature continue within that state for a period or periods aggregating more than 90 days. So if you take the periods of A, B, and C, which will come up to 90 days. Now, let us take in instead of this, let's say this A, B, and C had come to India altogether in nine for those 30 days. The issue arises, can the revenue say that I will take 31 days of A in January, 31 days of B, and 31 days of C? Trying to say that had they come separately, then the matter would, it would take 3 months. They have come together and now they are fast in the work, and the work has happened in 1 month as against 3 months. And therefore, I will take into account man days. This is the issue here. And really the answer, as I said, this is the crux of the issue. And if you go to the relevant word in the treaty says that the activities continue for a period of periods aggregating 90 days. So the activity of service must continue for 90 days. Now here, though ABC have come in January and all have rendered 31, 31, 31. Activity is not 91. And therefore, the tribunal held that you have to take into account solar days and not man days. The second issue arose, let us take if one person has come into India from January to March, and so to say 90 days are up. But those last, there is also an exam in India, which he's wanting to come and sit, which is on 31st of March. And those 15 days, last from 15th March to 31st March, he's studying for that exam. And so to say, he has been in India for 90 days, the threshold is over. But out of that 15 days is going for a study leave. It could be anything. It could be maybe he's come here to get married or whatever else. But 15 days is doing for some personal work. Whether this 15 days has to be excluded? And the answer will be self-evident from the treaty itself. Because the treaty says the activities of that nature continue beyond a period of 90 days. So clearly getting married or giving an exam is not an activity of that nature, which is that particular service he's rendering, and therefore it should be excluded. This was the tribunal finding. So I've explained all this. Maybe just the tribunal finding, we can just have a quick look. So tribunal said that the said employee had not rendered any service in India from 17th April to 4th May, as he was availing a study leave, and therefore it had to be excluded. And they relied on another decision and said that multiple counting of employees in a single day is not permissible. Now, so this takes care of the PE issue. This takes care of the service PE issue. Now we come to a construction PE issue here in this particular case. So before that, if I may read the relevant provision, which is Article 5.2. 5.2 says a term permanent establishment includes a construction project where such activity continues for a period of more than 9 months. The relevant, that is what we are concerned with. A PE includes a construction of a construction or assembly project where such project or activity continues for a period of more than 9 months. This we are concerned with this. Now, the issue here is, here the assessee was doing grouting activity. Grouting is something like if there are undersea cables and you're doing a cementing of that, it's some like there's a construction around the cable. The grouting activity is carried out in India for less than 9 months, which is a threshold limit, on various projects to protect the subsea pipelines, cables, etc. Would that grouting activity amount to a construction activity so as to constitute a PE under 5.2H? Or, so this is the issue. Because if it amounts to, if I come under construction PE, and if the number of days are less than 9 into 30, which is 270, then there would not be any PE. So this is the issue here. So the facts here are, the SSC, a tax resident of UAE, was engaged in providing grouting and precast solutions for subsea offshore construction industry. The AO contended that the grouting activity is not a simple masonry work, like construction the way we understand, but it involves complex aspects, and held that the grouting activities fell within the general Article 5.1, which is so to say fixed place of the India-UAE DTA. The SSC, the blue is SSC's contention, the SSC contended that the grouting activities fell within construction activities, and since the construction activities was less than 264 days, it did not have PE. They also, as an abundant caution, raised an argument. They said there were a number of construction activities in India, and the aggregation of that was also 264 days, less than the 270 days threshold limit. But they also raised a plea that they said that aggregation is not permissible. I think the reason sometimes an SSC raises a plea, because it's a very close gap, 264 and 270. And in the next year, what if this 264 becomes 271, and therefore a plea is taken really to protect from a future perspective also. Though in this case, it may not have been relevant. However, when the matter went to the DRP, DRP said that no, this is not construction, but since the SSC is using an equipment for grouting, and that equipment is in India for such a long time, 264 days. And by and large, you know, in the past, always 6 months was considered as a good threshold. Here it is there for more than 6 months. And it's a construction PE. So, mind you, not construction royalty we're talking of. We're talking of a construction PE. And they said clearly, notwithstanding the 270 days not being fulfilled, it was not a construction PE, it was an equipment PE. So this is what they held. Now, this is what the tribunal held. The tribunal said, if I may read the third bullet first. They said the concept of equipment PE is not envisaged in India at all. In the India-UAE DTA, there is no, so to say, equipment PE envisaged. So what the DRP is saying is clearly wrong. I think, yeah. So they said clearly there is no such thing of equipment PE in India. Now I'm coming to the first bullet. They said now, then you have a construction PE article, and then you have the general 5.1 article. And they said they will go by the principle, a well-accepted Latin maxim, which says that the specific will ride the general. So if something falls under general and something falls under specific, then the specific provisions will apply. And they said clearly this was a construction activity. And if since 270 days was not fulfilled, there was no PE. They further held that what the bifurcation was done by the lower authorities, that construction must mean simple and not complex. He's saying there is nothing such written in the treaty, and you cannot add words to the treaty that construction means simple and not complex. So this is what they held. And for completeness, they said that in any case, the application of aggregation principle, I'm on the fourth bullet, the application of aggregation principle of even connected sites, projects, or activities was not permissible because the treaty spoke of a construction site or project. The word a was there. And therefore, there was no scope even to aggregate. So in a way, they gave a finding which would take care of the subsequent years also. And I would think, in my respectful opinion, a right decision. So this is what they held. Now, on aggregation, I just for the completeness, there are treaties like Australia, Thailand, Canada, USA, Denmark, they're able to aggregate. Unlike the treaty which we are concerned with right now, with the India UAD, DTAA, just for the completeness, I may point out. Second is when the DRP spoke of equipment PE and the tribunal said there is no equipment PE under the India UAD DTA. Quite frankly, I am not able to find this PEs many places. I could, my junior Harish Bhafna, who's assisted me, could only locate Australia, where this equipment PE was there, so to say. So let's say we will not get influenced by this. But let's say even if a treaty talks of equipment PE, the question arises, so most of the treaties don't talk of it. And in that case, what would one say? So on special versus general, the law is well settled. There's a case of stock engineers, we had argued maybe 10 years back, the Mumbai tribunal. So this stock engineers was a case where there was the allegation was, is there a service PE or is there a supervisory PE? The threshold for supervisory was, the threshold of days for supervisory PE was much more than the service PE in that particular treaty. The assessee, the department's case was that supervisory is also a service. And therefore, if you fall under service PE article, and if the threshold is fulfilled, there is a PE. And the tribunal held no, that yes, supervisory service is a service, but it's a specific clause dealing with it. And it's a specific will override the general. And therefore, one would go by that. So they applied this judgment, also applied the well-accepted principle of specific versus general. And I think took the correct view. The next decision, which is the last one on the PE issue. Now here we have multiple PEs. So here I've written in this particular case, the client is dealing with the ICO. And the ICO refers the work to EFCO for a particular work. And the sharing is done. EFCO takes 90% of the work. 10% of the fee is maintained, kept by ICO. The issue in these facts is whether rendition of grading services on a revenue sharing basis by EFCO to its Indian subsidiary, would it result in a PE in the form of a subsidiary of the SSE in India? So let's just let's just come to the facts here. So here the SSE was a tax resident of USA, engaged in the business of diamond grading and preparing diamond dossiers. As per the GIA, which is the SSC, Gem Grading Services Agreement, which was entered into by various entities of the group, including the SSC and its Indian subsidiary, whenever any member of a group faced a capacity or a technical constraint for grading diamonds, it could send those stones for grading to the other countries of the group, including the SSC. That was the business model. So whoever has a shortage, I am dealing with a client, but I don't have the bandwidth. Okay, I will give this work to one of my group concerns. Whatever revenue I get for that, referring that work, I'm retaining 10%. For doing the work, whoever does the work keeps 90%. That was the basis. That comes out in the second bullet. So this was the arrangement done. Except that one critical fact here is, in the first bullet, the last two sentences, is that the two graders who were earlier employed with the SSC, you're talking about the USA entity, were currently employed at the Indian subsidiary, but working under the control and supervision of the Indian subsidiary. So this is another angle to this matter. The AO held that the US entity was actually carrying on its business in India through its PE as a joint venture. And the joint venture is, you do the work for me. If you refer the work, I'll give you 10% and I'll keep 90%. And they said, this is a JV. And therefore, the SSE had a PE in the form of a subsidiary and attributed 50% of the grading fees received by the SSC from its subsidiary to the said PE. So if the client is giving 100, 10 is retained by ICO, 90 goes to EFCO. EFCO's India government says that out of that 90, 45 is attributable to India and that should be taxed in India. The SSC said, look, whatever you may say, let's go by the language of the treaty. And as per the language of the treaty, there is no service PE, there is no agency PE. Where is the question of a P or any attribution? So the tribunal gave its finding on all the aspects, whether it on fixed PE, service PE, and agency. Tribunal first observed that the mere fact that a company had a controlling interest in another by itself would not mean that the other company is its PE. And this is there in almost most of the treaties, that merely because I have a subsidiary or I have a control over a company in another state, that other company does not become my PE. So that tribunal first said that is the first principle. Second, they said that the transaction of grading services was between the SSC and its subsidiary, and it could not be considered to be a joint venture. Why? They said the subsidiary bore all the risk, including the credit risk, client-facing risk, risk of all damage of articles in transit. That is all economic risks. Since the subsidiary has its own independent expertise, but only due to its technology or capacity constraints, it forwarded the stones to the SSC. So it was not a joint venture. They were on a principle-to-principle basis, really. And they said, so you can't say that the EFCO is using the premises of the ICO. The two are separate. It's not a joint venture. There was the question of fixed place PE would not arise. As regards service PE, they said that the graders, you know, were working under the control and supervision of the ICO in India and were on its payroll. Therefore, no service, so to say, was being rendered by the EFCO. This we will deal with when we come to FTS separately, this issue. And they relied on the decision of E-Funds of Delhi High Court, which is affirmed by Supreme Court, wherein it was held that the two employees deputed to E-Fund India did not create a service PE, as the entire salary cost was borne by E-Fund India and they were working under the control and supervision of E-Fund India. So they said there was no service being rendered by the EFCO. And as regards agency PE, the tribunal held that the subsidiary was actually bearing all the client-facing risk and did not have any authority to conclude any contracts in India on behalf of the SSC. So clearly there was no agency PE also. So this takes care of the PE part of this, all the important judgments in the last 15 months on PE. Now we come to royalty issues. The next five issues which we will discuss is on royalty. Most of you would have read this famous judgment, Reliance Jio. Here the issue is whether payment made for bandwidth services amounts to royalty under the India-Singapore Treaty, and what is the scope of Article 3.2 of the treaty. So first, let's just explain what is the Indian Act say, and then we'll go to what the treaty says, what does Article 3.2 says, and then together what it means. So if you go to the Act, then Explanation 2 to 916 says, royalty means consideration for, I'm reading Roman 1, the transfer of all or any rights in a process. These are the relevant words. So royalty means consideration for the transfer of all or any rights in respect of any patent, invention, model, design, secret, formula, or process, or trademarks, etc. And then explanation 6 at the bottom of this page, slide 48, says, for removal of doubts, it's hereby clarified that the expression process includes and shall be deemed to have always included transmission by satellite, including uplinking, amplification, conversion of down for downlinking of any signal, or through cable or optic fiber or any such similar technology, whether or not such process is secret. So process includes, now just the underlying part, process includes any transmission through cable, whether or not such process is secret. Now here, in this particular case, the bandwidth charges, the service which was being rendered of bandwidth charges, was through undersea cables. And clearly there was transmission of those bandwidth charges through bandwidth, through the cable, and the secret and the process, there is no some huge technology or some IPR involved in this activity. It is by normal cables, and that cable, that process, it need not even be secret. Anybody can do it, any small technician will be able to do that aspect of the cable part. So if one goes prima facie on the language of the act, it seems that bandwidth charges would amount to royalty under the act. If one goes to the treaty, I'm on site 48, royalty means payments of kind received for the use of or right to use secret formula or process. Now, Article 12.3 is not explicit the way explanation 6 to 917 is. So they are not providing that transmission by satellite or cable will be part of royalty, which explanation 6 is providing. So this was the issue, and whether bandwidth would amount to royalty, whether under the act, under the treaty, whether it would amount to FTS under the act, treaty, and from a treaty perspective, whether one could use, go to Article 3.2. Let's read Article 3.2. Article 3.2 says that any term not defined therein shall, unless the context otherwise requires, have the meaning which it has under the law of that state. That is what it is. So the case of the revenue can be that royalty refers to payment for a process, and process includes, as per explanation 6, process includes transmission by satellite or cable, whether or not such process is secret. So since the word process is not defined in the treaty, one can take the meaning of process from the act by virtue of Article 3.2. And then if one takes that, then clearly even under the treaty, this will amount to royalty. So these are the relevant provisions. The very brief facts here is there is a Singapore-based company called Reliance Jio Infocom Limited, who's the assessor. This is an Indian company who's the assessor. Reliance Jio Infocom Limited, it's an Indian company, assessee. They were in the business of rolling out telecom services in India. The ICO entered into a bandwidth services agreement with Reliance Jio Singapore, which is the FCO, which enabled it to establish, install, maintain, operate, and provide telecommunication services in Singapore. In pursuance of this, Reliance India paid Reliance Singapore a particular sum, and they filed an appeal under Section 248. And the claim of the SSC was that, look, the income earned by Singapore is a business income. There is no PE, and the question of taxation does not arise. And of course, and they also said there is no FTS, no royalty. The CIT gave a finding that these service bandwidth services were really standard telecom services without any human intervention. That's the Bharti Cellular famous case. And since there was a standard telecom services without any human intervention, it could not be fees for technical services under the act. Further, it also did not make available any technical knowledge, experience, or skill. It was just a cable which was, the bandwidth was going through that. So there was no making available of any technology. Therefore, it was clearly not FTS under the act and the treaty. For royalty, the CIT appeal held that the SS, for as far as process royal, as is concerned, the SSC did not have access to any process, first thing. the infrastructure, all the cables and the process were under the control of the EFCO. Further, the process was not even secret. There was no IPR owned or registered in the name of the EFCO, the Singapore company. It was a standard commercial process followed by industry players. And one could not say that the assessee had really paid for the use of an equipment or for the use of any secret process. So really the case here was that the assessee is paying for a service. The service provider may use any equipment or a process, but the assessee is paying for the service and not for the equipment or the process. And in any case, it was not a secret process. Further, there was no IPR in the process also. And then the CIT said there is no PE, it's business profit and not taxable. The department went an appeal and they accepted the plea of FTS. So the department accepted, yes, there was no PE, meaning thereby if it's business income, there's no taxation. They also accepted that it was not FTS. The only issue was by the department, that this was covered under the Act as well as the treaty read with Article 3.2. And for Article 3.2, which says you can import a treaty term from the Act into the treaty if it is not defined, they relied on a Bombay High Court judgment in the case of Siemens, which says an ambulatory approach should be followed. So this reliance you had come to the tribunal on two occasions. So I am really blending the two findings put together, because the first one did not deal with Article 3.2. The second one dealt with 3.2. So I'm just merging the two for a better understanding. So the tribunal decision was that the assessee received standard facilities under the treaty. The finding of the tribunal is under the treaty only. That the assessee received standard facilities. It did not have access to any equipment or have any access to any process. The infrastructure and process were under the control of the EFCO, which is the Reliance Singapore. Further, the process was not secret. That is, IPR was not owned or registered in the name of EFCO. The amount paid by the SSC was not towards the use of any industrial, commercial or scientific equipment or any secret process. Tribunal also noted that royalty definition under India-Hungary DTA takes within its sweep transmission by satellite cable optic fiber. So the language of the treaty, so to say, to some extent, is also there in the India-Hungary treaty, which is not there in the Singapore treaty. They also noted that post the amendment in the Act, the Singapore treaty was amended, and this amendment from the treaty made a note of this. And they said, you really now cannot import an amendment from the Act into the treaty. So this was in the first round, these were the findings. In the second round, in the second case of appeal, which happens later on, which is what we're concerned with, the department argued, took up a new ground and said, if you go by Article 3.2, then Article 3.2 says that any term not defined in the tax treaty, you can take that meaning of that word from the Act. And this is the tribunal's finding. The tribunal said that any term which is defined, so the tribunal made a difference between the word, it's a treaty word and treaty term. So tribunal said a term is defined as a word or a phrase used to describe a thing or to express a concept, especially in a particular kind of language or branch of study. So a term is thus, I'm reading just the bold part, a term is thus in addition to the word, in addition to being a word. So a term consists of word, but every word is not a term. That was a fine. That was what they said. And they said, yes. So only as far as undefined treaty terms are concerned, one can go to the Act by virtue of 3.2. And they said that really the treaty term is royalty. And if the treaty term is royalty, and royalty is defined under the Act, under the treaty, then you cannot go to it under the Act. The word process is just a mere word. It is not a treaty's term, so to say. And you cannot borrow from the Act. You cannot use it. You know, you cannot take the meaning of the process from the Act into the treaty. So I must, in all frankness, confess that, you know, while I had argued this case, but a lot of this material is the original work of Mr. Pramod Kumar, who has authored this judgment. And I think it becomes an important piece of international tax jurisprudence, what he has run, on Article 3.2. Then he went further and said, yes, if you go by New Sky's judgment of the Delhi High Court, then you can't go on dissecting. So you can take a meaning, a treaty term meaning from the Act. But if a treaty term consists of certain words, then you can't dissect it further and I'll say, I'll go to the Act for that particular word. That, to what extent does one dissect? That was the argument. And and then as regards ambulatory static interpretation versus ambulatory interpretation, they made a point. They said in the Siemens case, the German treaty used the word that you can borrow a meaning from the Act, which the Act has under the laws in force in that country. So in 3.2, a parallel 3.2, which was 2.2 in the German treaty, the language was in application. I'm reading the what I've put it in quotes in my handwriting. In the application of the provisions of this agreement in one of the territories, any term not otherwise defined in the agreement shall, unless the context otherwise requires, have the meaning which it has under the laws in force in that territory. And they said the words laws in force is not there in the Singapore Treaty, and therefore one cannot apply it here. And they also relied on a Supreme Court judgment of Canada, which says a unilateral treaty override is not permissible. Then they went to Vienna Law Convention and said that, Vienna Law Convention says that every treaty must be interpreted in good faith. And if a certain position has been accepted under the Indian law, then you can't unsettle that. You cannot then borrow from the Act into the treaty. A lot of emphasis was laid on good faith also. So these were his original findings. Let me just point out, if I come back to Article 3.2, we had raised another point here, which is not covered in the order, but I thought I'll just share that with you. So as you can see, Article 3.2, it says it has under the law of that state concerning. So if as regards the application of the agreement, any term not defined therein shall, unless the context otherwise requires, have the meaning which it has under the law of that state concerning the tax. So it does. Okay, so that was one point he made. We had argued that, look, the article says unless the context otherwise requires. So if you import the process definition into the treaty, then it will read as royalty means, I'm reading on the top, the underlined part, payments of any kind received for the use of a right to use secret formula or process, blah, 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 from the explanation, whether or not such process is secret. So we said, when the treaty is saying secret formula or process, it's obvious that the secret applies to process also. And you can't now import it, the treaty, the definition from the Act, because then this is how it will read. It will mean royalty means payments of any kind received for the use of or the right to use any secret process, blah, 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 whether or not such process is secret. So it would give an absurd result. And therefore, one has to take into account unless the context otherwise requires, and therefore even by virtue of this argument, which will lead to absurd results, one cannot import it into the treaty. Of course, this was not dealt with, but having said that, some original points on international tax jurisprudence was put by the learned member, Mr. Pramod Kumar. We had argued one other point also. We had argued this case under the Act also. And we said that even if one goes to the Act, really there would not be any royalty, because royalty, when you're talking of a process, and if it's a payment for process, then essentially the person who's charging for the process must have an IPR in the process. And if he has no IPR in the process, the question of him charging for a process does not arise, or the question of me paying for a process does not arise. Here, the process is nothing but under simple cable, which a normal technician can, as far as cable is concerned, any normal technician can do. And therefore, in the absence of an IPR, you know, this would not be taxable under the Act also. And we had relied on a internal decision of Bharti Airtel, a very, very well-reasoned order. You all may have a look at it, 47 ITR Tribunal Section 418, Delhi Tribunal, under the Act also, but this was not dealt with. So this was on Reliance 3.2. The next issue we come to is on facts. Precious company had a TV channel, Taj India was its distributor and advertising agent. And it was a DAP for the advertising revenue, and they held for distribution. It was not a DAPE, and therefore the distribution income could not be taxed in the absence of a PE because it was business income. So I'm just saying, see how our revenue, how innovative they can be. In that particular case, they had tried it as business income, but in the absence of PE, it had failed. Here, they said they didn't get into the PE aspect. So they said here, the distribution charges which is being received by the Singapore company is really royalty. And they went on these words under the Act. They said royalty means consideration for the transfer of any rights, including the granting of a license in respect of any copyright for use in connection with television. So they said, look, so you are, the Singapore company is operating TV channels. There is a company, yes, we'll go to the facts. So the assessee was a tax resident of Singapore engaged in the operation of business of TV channels for exhibition of various programs. An Indian company, namely Set India, through layers of multi-system operators and cable operators, collected subscription charges from individual customers to view the channels and the programs telecasted on these channels. The said subscription charges collected were paid to the assessee after adjustment of the intermediary charges. The AO held that these payments made to the SSC were in the nature of royalty for the use of copyright. So just the similar facts there also, there was an Indian distributor, you're an Indian distributor, the money which goes, the distribution income which goes there, there they held it as business income, the AO. Here they said it's a royalty by virtue of that word TV mentioned in the royalty definition. When the matter finally went to the High Court said, referred to the definition of copyright defined under the Copyright Act, and said the term copyright means an exclusive right to do or authorize the doing of any of the following acts in respect of a work or any substantial part thereof. And the term work would mean a literary, dramatic, musical or artistic work or cinematographic film and sound recording. In view of the above, the court held that the assessee was not parting with any copyrights for which the payment can be considered as royalty. There was no parting of any copyrights. It was just a distribution model, which it was getting the distribution income. The court rejected the plea of the revenue that clause 5 of explanation 2 would be applicable on the ground that the caption payment was not for granting any copyrights, so and so. And they decided this issue in favor of the SSC. So from a TV channel company, whether you call it a DAP issue or royalty, the courts, both Bombay High Courts have decided the issue in favor of the SSC. The next issue which comes is, this is whether an SSC is liable to withhold taxes at the time of making payments to Amazon for web hosting charges. So some, you know, here the SSC was making payment to Amazon. Amazon was taking web hosting charges, whether this payment amounted to royalty. The language again used, here we are concerned with the word, royalty means payments of any kind for the use of or right to use any industrial, commercial or scientific equipment. So here we are concerned with Amazon is basically through its server, the SSC has taken some space in the server of Amazon. It's taken that server on hire, so, or the space in the server on hire. The issue arises whether under the Act and Treaty, can this amount be considered as a payment for the use or right to use any industrial, commercial or scientific equipment? Because if it amounts to that, because of the server, if I'm paying for the use of the server, and then it's certainly one of these equipments, then it would amount to royalty. That is the issue. And also we have to consider explanation 5-916, which says that for removal of doubts, this is an amendment which came in 2012 with retrospective effect from 76. It says that for removal of doubts, royalty includes and has always included consideration in respect of any right, property or information, whether or not such property is with the payer. So Amazon has it, I am paying it, I don't have it, so I don't have possession of it. Such property is used, whether or not such property is used directly by the payer, I'm not using it directly, I'm using it indirectly. And whether or not the location of such property is in India, with Amazon, clearly the server is outside of India. And they said, if you look into, if you take explanation 5 and you read it with equipment, clearly this amounts to a payment for equipment, notwithstanding all these conditions, it'll amount to a royalty payment. So the very brief facts are the SSA, an Indian company, had made payments to Amazon for web hosting charges. And the servers, I'm reading the last sentence of the first bullet, the servers were taken on hire from Amazon. That's the language used. And obviously no TDS was deducted and a disallowance was made in the 40A1 by virtue of the provision I just read. Now, as regards the act, this is interesting what the tribunal held. The tribunal held that the fees, so anything blue is in favor of the SSC, as I mentioned, red is against the SSC. Tribunal held under the Act that fees paid by the SSC was for the use of technology-driven services and cannot be said to be for the use of infrastructure or servers. That's a very important finding, even after the explanation. Further, they noted, this was a critical fact, they said the charges were variable, were not fixed but variable, and it varied with the use of technology. So if you take an equipment, then, you know, when you pay a rental for an equipment, it is fixed. But here, the charges were variable, which means you were paying for the technology, which depending on your usage. And it was not for the equipment, so to say, it was for a service. Very, very important finding here. And therefore, they said that it did not even amount to royalty under the Act. Notwithstanding the explanation, notwithstanding the fact, you know, the explanation says I may not have used the equipment directly, the equipment may be not in India. They said notwithstanding the explanation. I think important judgment. Then they further went and said, now as regards the retrospective amendment, they said in any case, you know, the amendment had happened in 2012. These transactions were in 2009 and 10. Therefore, assuming without prejudice that taxation arises, you can't have a withholding tax obligation with retrospective effect because it's, as we all know, there's a famous Latin maxim which says, lex non cogit ad impossibilia. The law cannot expect you to do the impossible. So when I had to deduct tax, the law was in my favor. 2 years later, the law changed with retrospective effect. So I cannot be penalized because it's an impossible act. As regards the treaty, they said in any case, one can't have a treaty override by virtue of the Act. And even on merits, they say, if you come to the treaty, then for an equipment royalty, the possession and the control of the server is critical. In the Act, one may argue otherwise by virtue of the explanation, assuming so. But in the treaty, it is critical, and your the possession and the control of the server was with USA Amazon, and therefore it was not a royalty payment. A similar view has been taken in a Mumbai tribunal decision in Rackspace. So one may refer to that. Now we come to Kingfisher Airlines. This is a Bangalore tribunal decision. Just a sec. Yeah, this is a Bangalore tribunal decision. Now here, this Kingfisher India basically is making payments to foreign aviation academies in Dubai, Germany, and Singapore for training its pilots and the cockpit crews outside India. And this training also includes the use of those airplane simulators. Simulators, as we all know, gives a real feel that you're actually in an aeroplane, though you're not in an aeroplane. So with the help of these simulators, a training is given. And a fee was paid to the academies in Dubai, Germany, and Singapore. And the issue was whether it could be taxed as FTS or royalty. So the relevant provisions are: royalty means consideration for the use or right to use any industrial, commercial, or scientific equipment. And since a simulator was being used there, the revenues case was clearly that this is a equipment royalty. And if you come to the definition under the Germany treaty, again, it talks of, I'm referring to the second bullet on this slide. Again, it talks of payments for the use of or right to use industrial, commercial, or scientific equipment. And if one sees the UAE treaty, again, the second bullet, it uses the words payments for the use or right to use industrial, commercial, or scientific equipment. So these are the, so clearly this the position is under all the three treaties, if a payment is made for the use of any scientific, industrial, or commercial equipment, it amounts to royalty. So this is as far as the simulator is concerned, because there were two payments, simulator and training charges. Now, if you come to training charges, whether it amounts to FTS, then clearly if one goes by the definition under the Act, you know, rendering of any managerial, technical, or consultancy services, this was clearly technical in nature, and it would amount to FTS under the Act, the training charges for the pilots. Under the India-Germany Treaty, the word make available is not used, and therefore similar to the Indian Act, and therefore it was difficult to say that it is not training is not fees for technical services under this treaty. UAE, there is no FTS clause at all for training. And for the Singapore treaty, I'm on the first bullet here, it clearly talks of make available. So fees for technical services which make available technology. So if one goes by all this, prima facie, one would have thought, okay, if at all, you know, one can try and make a feeble attempt to argue in the Singapore treaty that this training does not make available. You know, and in any case, simulator is there. And, you know, so it was a challenging case. I have explained the facts already to you, so I need not go through this slide. So here I may just say the CIT appeals finding. So CIT appeals, so remember there are two payments and three entities. So as far as the Dubai entity is concerned, CIT appeal decided in favor of the SSC and said that the charges for usage of simulators could not be treated as royalty, since the usage of simulator could not really be regarded as use of scientific equipment. And they said, if you go by the word scientific equipment, then one has to see things like uniqueness and non-availability elsewhere. Those conditions would not apply to simulator because it is not something so unique or something so rare. And they therefore really held that, also they held that it was really the payment was for the service being rendered. So with respect to the training charge, so they also held that though I'm actually paying for the training, and maybe the training is split into two aspects for, you know, the simulator is part of it. So I'm paying for the fees for technical services. The person who's training me is using a simulator to train me, but I am actually paying for the training charges. That was another finding of the CIT appeal. And with respect to trainers, proper training charges, they said, look, in the India-UAE, in the treaty, there is no article dealing with FTS. And if there is no article dealing with FTS, clearly it is in any case business income. And since there is no PE, no taxation, so they decided the two payments in favor of the SSC for the Dubai entity and affirmed the order of the AO for the other two entities. when the matter went to the tribunal upheld the order of CIT appeal with respect to simulator and said that the flight simulator was an essential part of the training. And the fact that separate hourly fees was charged did not mean that the SSC was hiring the same. It was a methodology of charging. But really, the SSC was paying for the training, which included the use of simulators. So clearly, it was only training. With respect to training, they said, no, clearly it is, there's no FTS article. Therefore, it's a business income, no PE, no taxation. With respect to the German entity, they held, and the Singapore entity, because here we had a slight challenge because German entity does not talk of make available. So they said, and quite frankly, trainings by and large, if, you know, when you're imparting training, the larger view is that you're making available technology to the other person because he can use, you're giving him imparting certain skills which he can use later on. So it was a little challenge here. So here the tribunal held that in any case, a retrospective amendment cannot be, you can have a taxation with retrospective amendment, you have a withholding tax obligation, and therefore there cannot be any 41 disallowance or whatever for non-withholding of tax. So this was the particular finding. Now, here I just want to point out, what if this payment is made today? You know, where there is no, you know, when you're going for a 248 or you're going for a 197 or 195, there are no retrospective amendments, and you're making a payment for training of pilot. And let us say if the country has an FTS clause, whether or not make available, what does one do today? So here I thought I'll share with you, I've written at the bottom in my ink, that Sahara Airlines has taken a similar view, which is against the SSC. So training of pilots has been held to be FTS because it makes available technology, etc. But here I may just point out three cases. One of the first one is United Heli Charterer. I've written on my right hand side in blue. 43. Now here, the pilots were for the helicopter. I don't think that will make much difference, whether whatever. And here it was held not to be FTS. And the reason here was that this was a basic training required and it was statutorily required, like how you're for driving, you need, when you need a license, you know, it, something like that. And these people were training and issuing a basic certificate statutorily required. And it was held that this does not amount to fees for technical services. That's first point. In another case of Lloyd Register, which is 36 SOT 293 Mumbai Tribunal, this was something to do a training activity, not something to do with the sailors, but a training activity vis-a-vis the shipping industry was being conducted. And they held that the payment for training did not amount to FTS, because training was a continuous process, and you know, when with the technology changing, one had to really go for frequent trainings, and they did not make available technology. So, depending on the facts of the case, I mean, there is scope to argue. You know, there is some scope to argue in favor of the SSC, notwithstanding Sahara Airlines. And so, this was some points I wanted to just share with you. And this brings us to the last case of royalty, which I thought was a very interesting case of Punjab High Court, and well-reasoned. So here is a case where a payment is made to a foreign company for supply of technical designs, drawings, etc., specifications, under the erstwhile India-Austria DTA. So though we have written erstwhile from the sake of completeness, but this judgment could equally apply to the current treaty also. So the issue is a payment made for supply of technical designs and drawings, whether it would amount to royalty. And if one goes by the definition of royalty, then royalty means any consideration for the right to use models, designs, plans. This is as per the treaty. And even if one goes by the act, whatever is bold I'm reading, royalty means consideration for the transfer of all or any rights in respect of a model or design. So clearly, payment for design seems to be royalty. The only difference here is both the act and the treaty use the word use. That is a critical word used there. Right to use designs. And even in the act, it is for use of design. Whereas here, there is supply of design. So one will wonder why this distinction is being made, but let's read the facts. So the assessee, an Indian company, entered into an agreement with an Austrian company, and the assessee was granted an exclusive individual right and a license to use manufacturing-related information to be supplied by the said Austrian company for the purpose of manufacturing and selling vehicles in India. The Austrian company supplied the requisite drawings, design specifications, whatever, and charged 3 million Austrian shilling for it. Thereafter, the agreement also contained another clause which said that the assessee would pay royalty to the Austrian company once the production started, and the quantification of the royalty would be based on the quantum of the sales made by the vehicle sold by the assessee. So here there were two payments. One was a 3 million Austrian shilling being paid for supply of the drawings and designs, and then a yearly payment being made as royalty on the basis of your sales. The assessee had offered the second payment as royalty and said that the first was not royalty. So what was the contention of the assessee? Contention of the assessee was that royalty definition under the Act and Treaty both talk of payment for use of design, whereas the use of design is happening only when the manufacturing starts. And at that point of time, the money I'm getting is clearly royalty. Right now, it is supply of design and not use of the design. And therefore, this 3 million is not a royalty payment and therefore not taxable. That was the case of the SSC. Now, the High Court, these are the findings. They said royalty would mean payments made to an owner for the ongoing use of its assets or property, such as, just a second. Is the video on? Is the video on?
Sunil bhai.
Yeah.
Yeah, we had off the video because what had happened was that was low, so we were not able to hear you properly.
Okay, so you can see only the slides.
We cannot see you. Okay. But we had purposely switched off the video.
Okay, fine. Yeah. Okay. So now, what the High Court held? The High Court held that the royalty would mean payments made to an owner for the ongoing use of its assets or property, such as patents or natural resources for its business purposes. Payment used for ongoing use. That's a critical phrase used by the High Court. Then the High Court relied on the Supreme Court judgment in the case of Entertainment Network and held, wherein it was held, that the remuneration paid on a continuing basis rather than a payment consisting of a lump sum would be royalty. This was a Supreme Court observation vis-a-vis an author. The court also relied on another Supreme Court judgment in the case of State of HP versus Raja Mahendrapal, wherein it was held that a payment reserved by the grantor of a payment, lease or mine or similar right and payable proportionately to the use made by the right by the grantee would amount to royalty. Then they said that if you go by the dictionary meaning, the royalty is defined to mean a sum of money that is paid by an oil or mining company to the owner of the land that they are working on. So again, the use aspect they are highlighting. So if you see the first bullet, the emphasis was on ongoing use. See the last bullet, the emphasis on what they are working on. Working on means using, again, manufacturing. Then they said that the Austrian company had merely authorized use to the taxpayer. However, its actual use had arisen only on the commencement of production. And that would be the stage at which royalty would become payable. And the court held that the tribunal had given an unnatural meaning to the term supply. And the tribunal had said there is no difference between supply and use. And the High Court said, no, the tribunal is wrong in saying that. There is a difference between supply and use, the High Court said. And they said that the actual use of the said drawings and designs would start only once the production started. Until then, this lump sum payment was not in the nature of royalty. Now, you know, very interesting case. I have written some in ink. There are these three judgments of the Calcutta High Court, Gujarat High Court, and Delhi High Court, what you see on your screen on page 76, dealing with UK Treaty, US Treaty, and Delhi and Thailand Treaty and the Act, taking a similar view as taken in this court. And there are tribunal decisions also on this point. But what makes this judgment unique is, in all these other favorable cases, there was only one lump sum payment being made, and they said it does not amount to royalty. Here is a case where there are two payments being made under the same contract, and the recurring payment is held to be royalty, and the lump sum is held not to be royalty. And the question really arises is, can one commercially plan a contract and take into account the tax element? For example, if the grantor of a right is saying, you pay me royalty and 20%, example, 15% on your sales, can the payer say, okay, look, you know, why don't we do this? Instead of paying you 15%, I'll pay you 5% and I'll make you a lump sum payment right now. And that lump sum payment will not be taxable in your hands. And they can make some commercial advantage out of this. This is a question, of course, this judgment will be tested, but it's a very interesting judgment. I've not come across too many judgments where there are two payments under the same contract. One is royalty and one is not, and both are pertaining to the same, so to say, designs. But interesting judgment on this aspect last year. So this completes our thing on royalty. And now we come to FTS decisions. Now, you know, in Kingfisher's case, we discussed on the training aspect. And in Kingfisher's case, you know, the ruling was kind of a training amount to make available of technology. But because of a retrospective amendment, the withholding tax liability was not there, and thus it went in favor of the SSC. Now, what if, now there is no amendment, etc., and we are talking about now training through a web-based training. You know, so there is training which is web-based. So whether web-based training services provided to SSC's employees by its foreign associate company, would it be in the nature of FTS under the Act as well as under the India-US DTA? So the real question to be answered here is, you know, what I've actually scraped is, if I'm receiving a web-based training, and it is training, does it amount to make available of technology? It's a technical training. Does it amount to making available of technology under the India-US DTA? Now, here I may point out, so this is a part of the MOU of the India-US DTA, which is giving examples of make available. And they are saying the typical categories of services that generally involve making technology available include training, technical training. So as per the MOU of the India-US DTA, a technical training would really amount to making technology available. And here we are talking about a web-based training. So prima facie, one would think that this would amount to making technology available and therefore taxable as FTS. So here the SSC, an Indian company, was engaged in software development services. It made various payments to its USA-based associate company, Dhirian Company. And one of the payments included training charges. The AOS case was clearly, it is FTS, it makes available technology, no TDS deducted, therefore disallowance was made under 40A1. the SSC contended that they were not FTS as it did not make available technical knowledge. The tribunal's finding was interesting. They said that the training fees paid by the SSC was not for, not a case of interactive session. And it was akin to reading a book or an article, or even if a particular person availing services had a query, there was no facility to answer the same or on the web. It was in a way, a standardized mechanical training, which is not interactive. So they went into this aspect of it. And they said that the training availed by the employees of the SSC were web-based services available on the internet, and no technical knowledge was being imparted by the service provider. And thus it did not make available technology. So I thought this was an interesting judgment. Very few cases you have of training which do not make available technology. So as I mentioned in the earlier slides, we've had cases where you say the training is required on a regular continuous basis and therefore does not make available technology. We may have cases to say that it's a basic training, a basic certificate like a driving license, which are mandatorily required and therefore does not make available technology. Or this is giving a third dimension right now, which is if the training is standardized or a mechanical, which is not interactive, then it does not make available technology. I thought an interesting facet has come out in this judgment. It is something like, when the courts held that when a standardized facility is there, or a standardized software is there, a standardized supply of standardized software would not amount to royalty, or a standardized facility would not amount to FTS. Here it is a standardized training would also not amount to FTS. So interesting dimension here. The next case here is of Spencer Stewart. Last year there were many cases on software royalty, which I have not taken any of them because we know that Delhi has taken the view in favor of SSC, Karnataka has taken against the SSC, and Supreme Court will decide it. So I've not really gotten to it. Make available, there are several cases, whichever ways, where the principle is applied. I've not gotten to too many of that. We don't have too many cases on ancillary and subsidiary. So if a payment is made for a service, which is ancillary and subsidiary to another agreement, the income wherefrom is from royalty, then that would amount to FTS. So very few cases available, and one of them came last year. So this isn't that case. So this is a case of a Dutch company who had entered into two separate agreements with its Indian subsidiary. One, for granting right to use software, and two, to render executive services. So the company is earning two sources from the ICO, its subsidiary. One is the ICO is paying them for the use of software, etc. And two, ICO is paying them for certain executive search services. Admittedly, the fee for the grant of right of use of software here in this particular case was accepted to be royalty. The question arose is whether the second services, that is executive search services, could it be considered to be ancillary and subsidiary to the first and therefore FTS? So the relevant part of the treaty is given below. Fees for technical services means services for rendering any technical or consultancy services. If such services make available technology, etc., or are ancillary and subsidiary to the application or enjoyment of a right, property or information for which a payment described in para 4 is received. So here clearly there is a royalty payment. The question is whether the payment for executive search services can be FTS because it is ancillary and subsidiary to the royalty payment of the software. So here the facts are so I've already said there are two agreements here on the second bullet, service agreement and license agreement. One of them is clearly royalty. The issue is whether the service agreement amounts to FTS. The SSC had argued before the lower authorities really on make available that it does not, the executive search services do not make available technology and it's not FTS. But the AO said, no, we'll have to look into, clearly under the Act, it is FTS, because FTS and under the Act, make available phrase is not there. And also under the treaty, they said the fee for such services were ancillary for the application of enjoyment of a right, and therefore it was FTS. And alternatively, the AO held that though the NICO was supposedly for the search services, but really for that executive search services, they were in a way accessing the worldwide client database or the mailing list database of the foreign company. And since it was for the use of a database, it was in any case taxable as royalty. The tribunal held, on the APA, wherein the two agreements were held to be constituting different sources by the APA. And the finding was that the principal business of the subsidiary was to carry out executive searches. Since it was a principal activity of the foreign company, it could never be ancillary and subsidiary to the software activity, which was not the principal business of the SS. So these were the two things tribunal held. And third thing tribunal said, Kate, look, you can't say that this payment for search services is really for the database, because database is in any case covered by the license agreement for which royalty is being taxed. Here, what I want to highlight in this judgment is the critical points here are the first bullet and the second bullet. What if it is not, the second bullet says that the executive search activity is the principal business. What if it is not the principal business? Would it become ancillary and subsidiary just because it is not a principal business? And my answer would be that the principal business is an additional plus point in the judgment. And merely because in some other case, it is not a principal business or the main business, that additional plus point is not there. It is not a minus point. In fact, what is critical is that the two agreements are separate and distinct. Because clearly in this case, one is an executive search services agreement. And the other one is for use of software and other IPRs. There is no correlation between the two. The two are separate and distinct. In my mind, the first finding is really the critical finding. The second finding is an additional plus point, which in some other case, even if it is not there, I think on the basis of a first finding, one should be able to sail through on that. Now, when we come to this case of Bureau, this is a very interesting... you want to stop here?
Huh? Yeah, because it's already 7:45.
Yeah, fine.
So, otherwise, in this topic, how many judgments are left still?
No. So, you're 17, 18, 19, 20. There are five more judgments on FTS.
Okay. So, I think then let's just stop.
We can continue. We can continue on the decision.
Yeah. Okay.
So, start your video. The judgments, no? Till,
sorry?
One second. I think the host has disabled it. If you can...
Achha. Maitri, can you start it? Okay. Chalo, we'll...
The host has asked to start your video. Okay.
Hi, now it is starting.
We can...
You are visible. Yeah, thanks Sunil bhai for such a detailed analysis of each and every judgment which you have dealt with, and I think it will help a lot to all the professionals. Just to remind all, we are having a second part of it on day after tomorrow, that is Friday 15th at 3:30 p.m. So we'll be dealing with balance judgments on this. And another point is that we are having a study course on international taxation. We have already completed 4 sessions and still 5 sessions are left. So if anybody want to enroll for that, you can enroll. If it is a paid one, so if you want to enroll, there are balance 5 are left. So with this few words, I will request Siddharth to offer a vote of thanks.
Thank you, Rajesh bhai. I have the pleasant task of proposing an interim vote of thanks, because as Rajesh bhai said, that this is just the part one of our series on recent international tax rulings. Sunil sir, I would really like to thank you for painstakingly gathering all these decisions and compiling them. I can only imagine the Herculean effort, which would have gone in grouping together all these judgments topic-wise. And further, for each of the topics, you have very meticulously laid down all the issues comprehensively, which would mean that, us as students of international tax, it becomes very easy for us to understand the various facets. In addition, your analysis, it's quite evident the way, you have highlighted some of the sentences, made your own notes. So that sort of also gives us an insight into how well prepared you were and, how you are, freely sharing your knowledge with us. And I believe that as I have benefited, all the participants too have indeed benefited from this session. With these few words, on behalf of the chamber, I would like to extend a very well-deserved vote of thanks. And thank you so much, sir, for being with us here today. And we look forward to the second session on Friday. Back to you, Rajesh. Okay,
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Sunil.
Okay, thank you.
Very enlightening session.
Thank you so much. Yeah, okay.
Yeah, we'll meet on day after tomorrow.
Yeah. What time, Rajesh?
3:30.
3:30?
Yeah.
3:30 to 5:30.
Yeah, 3:30 to 5:30.
Yeah. Okay. Thank you.
All right. Okay. Thank you, everybody.
Bye.
Bye.
Okay, bye. Thank you. Yeah, bye. Yeah.